it's most likely to emerge in social stress.
Well, when a culture loses its direction, in other words, there's no overall myth that's guiding everyone. We're in this position right now where there isn't an overall myth that guides everybody. There's lots of stories out there that guide you. This will give you a little bit of a review here. First of all, you have a group or charismatic leader that attracts others with a message. It may be a redefinition of the world, certainly Christianity was. Accepted by individuals who believe vision to be true, believable, and useful. So they're really talking to the conscious mind. People are consciously getting into these things, not brainwashing, at least to get you in. In many cases, depending on the group, certainly this wasn't something that I did in the group that I was in, but possessions are sold or given away. This certainly was the condition for that young lady who was in that cult up in Oregon. She's given away everything that she had. I think she even gave away her house. This creates a commitment. Individual becomes dependent. Acceptance of vision is slow or meets resistance, they withdraw, become more or less secretive, and this becomes a problem because now they can create their own rules and bylaws and so on. Members are often kept away from other family members. This young lady, her husband was kept away from her. She was divorced, but her husband was kept away from her. Parents were kept away from her and so on and so forth, so that they could really control the kind of information that was going into her head. Outsiders, family members and whatever, could pull her out of the system, so they're going to shut that off. That's kidnapping. It really is. It's kidnapping. And I don't think the authorities think of that too lightly. I mean, they don't take that very lightly. Controlling information is critical for maintaining group membership, and that's one of the reasons that they keep members. Messianic movement characterized by a messiah, like for example the second coming of Jesus, messiah, the anointed one, a deliverer who will save the world by instilling a new sense of social order. And this is, see, Jesus couldn't get it all done the first time, so he's going to come back for another try. We're not sure when this is going to happen. So there really isn't a time period for this. We know it's going to happen, but we don't know when. The millenarian movement, however, is time factored. To give you an example of this, 1000, when the year 1000 showed up or was about to show up, people were quite concerned that the world was going to come to an end during that And in Europe, many, many people gave away their land, their money to the church in order to make sure that they were saved and went to heaven and so on when the world came to an end. And you know, it's hard to believe, but it's true that their lawsuits are still going on in Europe to try and get this land back after 1,000 years. I don't blame them, but they're never going to get it back. They gave it to the church. Now, 2000. Remember 2000 when that was going to show up? What was going to happen? All the computers were going to crash. The world was going to come to an end. You know, we couldn't be able to mail anything. Or everything would just go belly up, if you will. What happened? Nothing.
Well, it continued.
Now, my neighbor up the street thought that the world was going to come to an end. He sold his house and he bought himself an ATV to bomb around in. He bought himself a couple of new guns, a lot of ammunition, a lot of food and whatever, and then 2000, 2001 shows up, nothing happened. He lost everything. He ended up having to move to Florida with his parents to reestablish himself there. He was an EMT. Individual was out there working every day, but he believed this, and he sold everything in order to protect himself and his family. Nothing happened. I don't know, how many of you remember 2000? How many were around in 2000? Okay, how old were you?
I would have been like third grade, because I was fourth grade. So
okay,
so 9/11.
Yeah, what did you think of all of this? Do you remember?
I remember people being weird and acting funny, but I don't necessarily remember.
Yeah.
Like exactly why, like it was a big deal that I was like, remember being like, oh cool, we're going to a new millennium, like that's awesome, like it was a cool thing, but remember there definitely being that side of it that were like everyone was nervous and scared, like why, it's another year.
Yeah.
I had a friend who was reading certain books and was so worried about it, and it's actually not true that nothing happened, because there was a lot of computer things that had to be fixed, but he had taken it to such an extent that I just thought he was worried.
Yeah.
It was just another day.
it's really what it was. I didn't know if the computers were going to crash or not. I mean, I'm not sure what kind of effect it would have had on me. I wouldn't be able to get my money out of the bank, probably. Yeah.
Weren't people mainly afraid that like the computers were going to crash and the nukes would launch, and that was kind of, you know, what would kick off the end of the world? That's what I heard.
The whole thing was going to end.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be awful. So that's a millennium. It's going to, and there's a time frame for millenarian movement, the time frame thing. And then what we get are what are called revitalization movements. And we'll be talking about one of those. This is a prophet who is going to return us to the good old days. And guess who that prophet was on 9/11? Bin Laden. He was a Wahhabist. They want to return to the good old days, living in a tent, riding camels, and so on and so forth. And that's what he was all about. He wanted to bring an end to the world. And he is an example of the dual hero, twin hero myth. This Bin Laden and Zarahari, his sidekick, who was a medical doctor. Zarahari, I believe, is still alive. Bin Laden, he was unceremoniously shot in the head, wrapped in a lead blanket and dropped into the ocean, as far as I know. They may have saved something, but the reason they did that is they didn't want people worshiping God. You know? And what's also kind of tragic about all this is the Saudis knew where he was all along. He was very rich, and they were making sure he got his money and so on and so forth, so he could live in that compound. They knew where he was. Our friends. Okay, let's get into some cults here. Now, ancient alien hunters, I have accused them of being a new Christian cult, and Van Daniken went livid when he saw my YouTube thing on this. We're not a Christian cult. He went on and on with this. It was in one of the ancient alien video sequences. I forget which one it was a couple years ago. Okay, what they did, essentially, they kept everything in place except for the gods and the demons, and they replaced those with space aliens. The greeners were the good guys, and the grayers were the bad guys.
evil aliens genetically engineered us to work in gold mines. So there you've got your creation story. They created us out of either Neanderthal or Homo erectus, so we're not quite sure. This is Zacharias Sitchin's stuff in his birth chronicle, which is silly. Good aliens taught us all we know. So we have these people that come down because we're dumb and stupid and we can't figure it out, and they show us how to do metallurgy and all this kind of stuff. They communicate with special people. And they communicate with Jesus. They communicate with Muhammad. They communicate with Abraham and so on down the line. They've inserted genius genes in special people to bring forth new ideas and new technology. And of course, Einstein is one of these people that they did this to, of course. Probably Schrodinger as well. Keep in mind, all those formulas for quantum mechanics are just ideas. You really can't prove a lot of this stuff. They sell it as true, the best case. Yeah. I've spent the last year working on the quantum stuff, and I can see that like, you can poke a lot of holes in what they're trying to say. But anyway, or they have inbred with certain humans producing exceptional offspring. And of course, there was a battle between the good greens and the able grays, and apparently it was a draw. And they use a Hindu text called the Mahabharata to prove this, because in that they talk about flying machines and so on and so forth. There's some real problems with that when you think about it. Where did these flying machines come from? Were they invented on Earth? And if they were, where's the industrial complex that developed them? You'd need special metals, special plastics, and so on to put these things together, just like we have today. But there's no evidence of anything. And what they have is evidence of atom bombs going off. We can show that these were caused by meteors or comets exploding above the ground and creating such heat and pressure, if you will, forming these glass shards, if you will, in certain areas of Egypt and so on. Evil is still about, causing chaos in the world. These are the evil grays, you see. This is, call it the deep state or whatever, but it's evil and it's controlling the world. Maybe it's the what's that, the Illuminati or whatever?
Illuminati.
Illuminati, yeah. Saying that they, you know, these people existed at one time, but whether it's a force out there telling the world how to work, I don't know. It's, who knows?
Freemasons.
Well, they're still around. Are they still, are they able
whether
to?
Whether they're string pullers is a magic thing or they are. Exist. There's one right there. There's a chapter just out of the Placerville. There's like Freemasons building right
there. Yeah, my father was a Mason. Never asked me to join. But the good greens will return and prevail. See, so we've got the second coming. It's going to show up again. So what we have here is essentially Christianity, just sort of twisted a little bit. And they don't like hearing that. What's also interesting is that the Catholic Church is kind of going in this direction. That maybe there was space aliens. So maybe it's a way for them to get out of the model that they created with respect to Jesus and all of that. I don't know. Have to see how this pans out. To me, it really appears that a lot of these UFOs is just technology that's founded on the Earth. It's here. A lot of these things that engage in behaviors in the air that no person could live through, they get squashed because of turning so quickly. These are just drones, if you will, that are out flying. But I don't know. I mean, I'm open to it, but I want to see the proof. You know, show me the money. Okay, let's consider a number of cults besides the ancient alien people. The Iroquois. Now, these people live in upstate New York. If you will. And the problem with the Iroquois is they joined the wrong group with the war with England. side of the wrong group. 1799, this is after we get the British out, The Brits, I look back at some of my ancestors and they did some awful things to people. And that's just a few hundred years ago. They're still capable of doing these things. The Brits are no angels whatsoever in terms of what they've done to people. Seneca chief by the name of Handsome Lake, they're probably a roaring alcoholic by this time. They had been marginalized by the colonists because they'd kicked out Brits and they had taken the side of the Brits. The Last of the Mohicans, have you seen the movie? There's two variations of that. One that came out in the 1950s, which is pretty good. Doesn't have all the cute technological stuff that the newer one was done about 15 years ago. That is a good indicator as to what was going on. There's a lot of fact in that. It's a good story. But there's some fact within that as well. Anyway, kick the Brits out. We marginalize the Iroquois because they supported the wrong group. Handsome Lake, he's an alcoholic, probably got liver damage, and he's hallucinating. And heavenly messengers came to him. Now, sometime back, we talked about the false base society and all that with the Iroquois. And we also talked about dreams that they would have, and that the brave dreamt that he was to be given beads, they would give it to him. If he was told by his heavenly messenger to sacrifice a dog, he'd do that. If the messenger said he was to have sex with a lady next door, that would happen, and so on. So what you're seeing is a little bit of that in this. He's visited by these heavenly messengers. And these messengers told him the good word. And the good word was, stop doing what you're doing and you're going to do something else in order to survive. And what are you doing that's bad? Well, you women are kicking your men out. You're divorcing them too quickly. You got to stay married. The men have got to stop sitting at home drinking booze and they've got to get out in the fields and start working to help the women. And so on and so forth. And you got to stop drinking alcohol. This was a very peaceful cult. People went along with this because it represented something in their culture, that is dreaming and dreams coming true, and you have to act on them. If you don't act on them, you'll lose the protection of your heavenly messenger, you see. So you've got to do what they tell you to do. And so he sold after the group. And now the Iroquois in upstate New York are fairly wealthy. They live on reservations, yeah, but they sell things that people want. What do they sell? Fireworks and alcohol and tobacco at a reduced rate, without tax and so on and so forth. So a lot of people go to these reservations to get these things. Now, they've made it pretty difficult here in California to go to these reservations to get some of these cherry bombs and things, which are kind of dangerous. We used to play around all that stuff when we were kids. I remember my father going to Maine, and before they had changed the laws in Maine, and you could buy these what are called 6-inch salutes, and they were like a quarter of a stick of dynamite. And I can remember being out in front, I was just a little kid, I was very old. My father was held over for a couple of years after the war was over because he was helping them to build MASH units and so on and so forth. And so this probably was about 1947, 1948, I forget when he came home. Anyway, he went up to Maine and he brought back a whole case of these 6-inch salutes. And my brother's 3 years older than me, and my father lit one of these and gave it to my brother. My brother's staring at him. Would have blown his hand off or killed him if he wanted. Father grabbed and threw it away from him. That's pretty powerful stuff. And pretty good giving it to a young kid like that. At any rate, they've got what people want, and so they sell this stuff. And they become fairly wealthy because they listen to the heavenly messenger. Very peaceful cult. Not so peaceful cult. The ghost dance religion. And here I get to tell you one of my favorite stories. This is around 1870. And of course this is after the Civil War. A lot of people moving west. You gotta get rid of the Native American Indians, they're in the way, and so on and so forth. So the U.S. Army was doing a lot of nasty things. They killed off the buffalo and so on and so forth. But this is when that started around this time period. We have a prophet by the name of Wabaka now. want you to look his name up on the internet. There's a question that I put onto the final exam about this. What is his Christian name? So look that up on the internet. He's a Paiute in Nevada, in the hills. And he starts to have dreams. And he's the one that promoted what's called the ghost dance, or the buffalo dance, if you will. A heavenly messenger came to him and told him that he was to tell his people to stop fighting, stop practicing witchcraft with one another, and this heavenly messenger would teach them a dance, the ghost dance. And if they did this dance, what would happen is that this land that they're standing on now would rise up about 3 feet or so, and then all of the Indians could jump up on it and gain all the technology of the Europeans without the Europeans being there. They leave them down here. And it's invisible. So they're going to jump up on this. They'll be on another land, and all these Europeans will be gone. Be gone. And he'll bring back all the relatives. All of your ancestors will come back as well. Be wonderful. Okay. This ghost dance is patterned after the buffalo dance. And I'll tell you the story that comes from the Blackfoot Indians. These are Plains Indians, if you will. And it's really the same story. So let me tell you a story. This time of the year on the plains, it's starting to get pretty cold. My brother lives in Maine, and they've just had a terrible storm that went through there. Again, it knocks out electricity for 2 or 3 days or whatever. At any rate, on the plains, this time of the year, it's starting to get cold, starting to snow, and if you don't have all your meat in, you're going to starve to death over the winter. Now, I know that you've seen the images of the Indians on horses riding along with these little bow and arrows, shooting arrows into bison and so on and so forth. Do you think that would really hurt a bison very much? Probably not. The way they did this is they would stampede the group over a cliff, and then they'd get on and process the animals. That's how they did it. And certainly not all the animals went over the cliff, but just a few of them. And that's all you need. And so the braves are out, and they're chasing the buffalo. And they get up to the cliff, and they veer off. And they keep doing this day after day after day, and they're really afraid that they're going to starve to death. So the chief has a daughter. And the daughter, one day, she goes out, and she's on a little hillock here. The plains are kind of hilly. And she's overlooking that cliff that they're trying to drive the buffalo over. And one more time, the braves are chasing the buffalo veer off, and she's standing there, and the buffalo come back, and they're kind of standing on the cliff, overlooking it. And the young lady says, "You, if anyone will come over, I'll marry you." And they all look at each other, and that sounds pretty good, and they all tumble over the cliff, now they've got to meet. So the young lady starts to leave. She's going to go back to the camp. And she turns around, and who's standing in back of her but the shaman of the buffalo. And he says, "Where are you going, girlie?" And she says, "Well, I'm going back to Daddy. I'm back to the village." "No, you're not. You said if one come over, you'd marry us, and so here I am." "Well, I'm going back to Daddy." "No, you're not. You're going with me." And so off she goes with the shaman of the buffalo. Well, come nightfall, Daddy's looking for his daughter and can't find her anywhere. And so, magpies are kind of shamanic birds, and there's one floating around over here. And so he asked the magpie, "Have you seen a young girl around here?" The magpie says, "Yeah, there's a lady over there with the buffalo. It's the strangest thing I've ever seen in my life. She's over there with the buffalo. We'll fly over and tell her that Daddy's looking for her, and I'll meet her down the watering hole in the morning." The bird says, "Okay, off he goes." Lands on a little girl's shoulder and says, "Daddy's looking for you." "Oh, no, that's me." "Yeah, he's going to meet you down the watering hole in the morning. Morning comes, and the shaman of the buffalo wakes up, breaks off a horn, don't worry, this is him. Gives it to her, tells her to go out and get some water. So down she goes. There's Daddy. Says, "You've got to get out of here, because if they catch you, they will kill you." Too late. Surrounded by the buffalo. The buffalo kind of look at each other, and then they trample Daddy to pieces. And they trample over him so much that there's only a little piece of his backbone that's left. It's laying on the ground there. And the dog was there, crying away. And the shaman looks at her and says, "What the hell are you crying about? What about us? What about our parents? Our daughters? Our sons and things? They're all dead. What are you crying about?" Well, with that, she kind of snapped to it. Got a blanket. And then she opens it up, puts it over the eyes up in the center of the blank. She looks underneath, not quite ready. She goes around a couple more times, and Daddy's back. And the shaman says, well, if you'll do that for us, we will teach you our buffalo dance, and you can bring us back as well. This is the story that Wabaka convinced individuals that they should follow. And the group that followed this were the Sioux. This was a short-lived call. The Sioux attacked the U.S. military at the Battle of Little Bighorn, and they killed almost everyone. A couple of the scouts got away. And there's a very interesting movie that came out, I believe it was in the early 70s, Little Big Man, do you remember that? With Dustin Hoffman. If you get a chance to watch it, there's some really good humor in that. I mean, it's a tragedy too, but there's some pretty good humor in it as well. Well, it's about one of these scouts that got away. And it tells a lot of its fantasy, but some of it's probably real as well. It's a very interesting story. This was June 25, 1826. This is 1876. Well, the U.S. Army didn't know let something like that stand. So you get the Battle of Wounded Knee Creek, December 29, 1890. And they went into the Sioux village and they killed everybody, women, children, everyone. But a number of the braves got away. These are the dog pony soldiers that they're claiming went up into Canada, and they may still be there. And there actually was a movie about this some years back. I forget what it was, called. But there was a very interesting movie about all this. Now, although the ghost cult disappears, it's no longer there, it merged with another cult that was coming up from Mexico, and that would be the Coyote cult. And so it was called the Coyote cult until 1918, and it's still quite viable out there. As a matter of fact, you can contact one of the individuals who sort of promotes this group in Utah, of all places, and you can actually get a license to consume mescaline because you become part of the church, and the church can do what it wants. And the church can even smoke cannabis. One of my friends up in Canada, Bennett, who hopefully read this thing in the Entheogens book, he helped to promote a religious tradition where they could consume cannabis, and they were able to do this. And a lot of people, and there were a lot of very famous people, Carl Rupp actually went up into Canada and went into the courts and talked about the use of these substances all over the place, and so now they can, at least in that, in Victoria anyway, they can use cannabis in their religious ceremony. All right, I want to show you a couple of things. This is a bulletproof vest. And when Sutter's Fort, if you go back into the late 60s, early 70s, before they changed the laws, they had a wonderful museum there with crania with arrowheads in them and so on. And they had a couple of these vests on the wall. And you knew that they didn't work because they had bullet holes in them, dried blood and so on and so forth. But these vests actually were based on vests that the Aztecs made. They were woven out of very tightly woven cotton, and arrows actually would bounce off these things. And so that was what they kind of patterned this off of. And all of these things that you see on here, these things, these are magical symbols to keep bullets away, and so on and so forth. Okay. Cargo cults. Now these are kind of interesting in a number of ways. The first cargo cult that I'm aware of occurred in the Philippines shortly after the Spanish-American War. I don't know much about it, but the individuals just were not used to all this cargo that was showing up on the island, if you will, and so they wondered where their cargo was. That's about as far as I know it, but we've got some others that I know a little more about. Back in the late 1960s, when I was a graduate student, this cargo cult was a thing. And there's two books, Burridge's book, New Heaven, New Earth, that you might want to look at, and then Worsley's book, The Trumpet Shall Sound. Both of these were very famous books that I sold a lot of. I think every graduate student I knew was reading this stuff. Because they describe these things and what was going on. So let me describe it for you. The These emerged in New Guinea and in the South Pacific after the Second World War. And you can imagine what's going on here. We've got these ships that are tying up in islands and offloading all of this kind of cargo, munitions and food and building materials and planes and tanks and all this. And the natives are, you know, where the hell would this stuff come from? And where's ours? The question of where's ours led to what they had done in history so that it was taken away from them. What if they had done in history is they had converted from their old religious tradition, Christianity. The gods were angry, and the gods therefore would not supply them with cargo. So what do? They get away from Christianity, they go back to their old system. So they were exposed to European trade goods, and the belief arose that in the future ancestors would come back if they did a few things, and one would be to go back to the ancestor world, what the ancestors were worshiping, and that the ancestors then would bring them untold quantities of goods.